So, you got invited to be part of the curriculum working group of BPSU College of Medicine. You are a content expert, no doubt. The question now is, how are you going to put that expertise in the context of teaching? How are you going to deliver the content you know so well in a form or in a manner that the generation of students today will be able to learn it? In this presentation, we will endeavor to find an answer to these questions. We will have an overview of the curriculum planning process, the curricular strategies, particularly outcome-based approach or outcome-based education, and we will also look at the principles and advantages of integrating the content of a curriculum. So at the end of the session, you should be able to first appreciate the process involving curriculum planning and appreciate outcome-based education as an education approach. According to Grant in 2014, the curriculum is more than just a syllabus or timetable. It embraces all the learning opportunities, both formal and informal. The concept of a curriculum has been widened to include all the experiences learners encounter that enable them to achieve the specified learning outcomes. It includes the learning outcomes, the teaching and learning methods, the assessment procedures, the educational strategies, the context for the learning, and even the learning environment. Therefore, curriculum is a holistic manifestation of essential elements and factors in a course of study, which together are identified, selected, expressed in coherent form, and implemented or improved on to produce the desired educational outcomes. From this definition of Bevis in 1973, we can see that a curriculum is not just a list of the subjects or topics that needs to be taught, but there should be coherence in it in such a way that there is rational and logical sequence and progression to these subjects. And even the choice of subjects or content to be taught depend on other influencing factors and elements that we've mentioned a while ago. This definition also describes that a curriculum should be improved, giving us insight that monitoring and evaluation of a curriculum is part of the curriculum planning process. These are the elements of a curriculum. We have four, that's needs assessment, curricular objectives, curricular strategies, and curricular evaluation. Each of these elements answer a directional question that helps us plan a curriculum, as these also correspond to the steps in the curriculum planning process. When planning a curriculum, the first question that we try to answer is, where are we now? To answer that question, we have to do needs assessment. The second question is, what is our direction? Defining or identifying our curricular objectives, or what we want to achieve using our curriculum, will tell us where we want to go. To bridge the gap from where we are now and where we want to go, we answer the third question: which approach is suitable? What curricular strategies are appropriate to bring us from point A to point B? And how do we know if we've achieved our curricular objectives? That's the fourth question: how are we doing? To know if we've reached point B, we conduct curricular evaluation. So that's the four elements and four steps in curriculum planning. However, curriculum planning does not stop at step four. It is a continuous and repetitive process of needs assessment because needs continuously change, and curricular evaluation to know where we are and how we are doing in terms of achieving our curricular objectives and implementing our curricular strategies. So let's dive deeper into each of these elements. We start off with step one, needs assessment. Where are we now? Health professionals work in the context of changing healthcare needs, professional practice, societal expectations, and socioeconomic, political, cultural, and educational factors, all of which influence the future roles and responsibilities of health professionals. The overall context and influencing factors form the basis for determining the needs of the curriculum on a local, national, or global perspectives, and the subsequent decisions that must be made pertaining to the different elements of a curriculum. For the health context, we have to take into consideration the characteristics of the population that our health professionals will serve, the environmental conditions affecting patterns of illness, existing health hazards, the health system, and the available health services. All of these influence the choice of content that we are going to put in our curriculum. For the professional context, we consider the exponential growth of knowledge and the scientific and technological advances. Of course, we will not teach our students, for example, diagnostic techniques and interventions that are not used in practice either because they are obsolete already or they are not part of the standards of practice yet. Both of these scenarios is feasible because of the exponential growth of knowledge. And that is why also, two of the soft skills that we develop in our students are evidence-based practice or evidence-based medicine and the skills of lifelong learning. For the societal context, expectations from various sectors or stakeholders, as well as economic factors affecting utilization of services and even political factors, all of these we have to consider because all of these influence the health and professional context that we have right now. That also includes the educational context. For the educational context, we take into consideration the characteristics of the students and even the characteristics of the faculty members, as well as the drivers of educational trends. Most notably, and particularly in the Philippines, one of the educational trends is the UHC Act, which institutes universal health care for all Filipinos, prescribing reforms in the healthcare system as well as in education system. To align with this, DOH, CHED, and PRC released a joint administrative order outlining the guidelines for the reorientation of the health professions education curricula and training programs to primary health care. So this joint administrative order and the UHC Act reorients the HPED or the health professions education to include primary health care in the curriculum of all health sciences courses. Another trend is the Dr. Para Sabayan Act, which established a medical scholarship and return service program for deserving students, which mandates state universities and colleges, including us, BPSU, to offer MD program to address the need of human resources for health, particularly doctors. Other educational trends include the Lancet report in 2010, which emphasizes the development of other skills necessary for professional practice and health service delivery aside from clinical competence. This report brought forward the outcome-based education, and although this educational approach has been in existence way before this Lancet report, CHED implemented OBE in 2012 in response to this and to enhance the quality assurance in Philippine higher education. If you are developing a curriculum for an institution that has a mission, vision, and educational philosophy in place, then these become part of the needs assessment as well. Because it tells us where the institution is in the bigger context. Makikita kasi natin sa vision and mission and philosophy kung anong klase ng school ang meron tayo at kung ano ang priority ng school natin. For example, BPSU College of Medicine envisions that by 2040, we have produced medical doctors that provide quality from basic to palliative healthcare services, leading to a healthier Philippines. As for our mission, we aim to produce competent, compassionate, collaborative, and community-oriented physicians to promote access to equitable health services for the people of Bataan in particular and the nation in general. Given this, our curriculum should be able to respond to this mission. Our curriculum should be able to produce medical doctors who are competent in providing quality, including basic, promotive, preventive, curative, and palliative health services in a compassionate and collaborative manner. Our curriculum should also be able to produce physicians who are community-oriented to address the needs of Bataeños and Filipinos in general. The BPSUCM's educational philosophy actually describes the curriculum that is needed and aligned with our vision and mission. That is, a customized curriculum that is innovative, that is vertically integrated, yet grounded in the disciplines, focused on student needs through the guidance of committed teachers in an environment that is strongly community-oriented, inculcating the expectations and contributions of each of our graduates to a healthier nation. But if you are developing a curriculum for an institution that has no vision, mission, and philosophy yet, then defining this should be the succeeding step after the needs assessment. All of the results of the needs assessment become the basis for decisions on other elements of curriculum. So that's the first step, that's needs assessment. The next step is formulating the curricular objectives. We know what is needed because we perform needs assessment during the first step. But in this step, we will identify what our direction will be. We know where we are now. But after that, where are we going? Saan tayo pupunta para yung needs natin ma-address natin? Curricular objectives or goals or outcomes translates to competencies expected of the graduates of the program. Ano yung mga outcomes na dapat kayang gawin ng graduates ng curriculum natin? How do we identify that? So we start with defining the professional roles and responsibilities that the graduates of our program will perform later after they finish the program. So for example, gaya sa program natin, one of the roles that we want our graduates to be is to become primary care physician. Another could be a researcher. After defining these professional roles and responsibilities, we break down each of these into their component tasks. So, bilang isang primary care physician, ano-ano yung mga tasks na ginagawa niya? No? Ano-ano ang mga tasks na ginagawa ng isang primary care physician? So, for example, manage patient in a primary care setting. So, that's an example of a task. After breaking down the professional roles and responsibilities into component tasks, we now define the professional competencies. No, ano yung knowledge, skills, attitudes, behavior na dapat meron ang isang primary care physician para magawa niya yung patient management in a primary care setting. So for example, mag-diagnose, diba? Mag-treat ng condition ng patient. Counseling, diba? Coordinating the care of the patient. So that's example, no? Those are examples. After that, we translate them to student competencies. Kunwari ang competency is diagnosis and management of a patient condition management of the patient's condition in the primary care setting. No. Ano dapat ngayon ang kayang gawin ng students para kapag professional na siya, kaya niya pa rin gawin. Sigurado tayo na magagawa niya yung ine-expect sa kanya. So for example, history taking, physical examination, mag-interpret ng laboratory tests, etc. So after identifying those student competencies, we categorize them into entry, intermediate, and terminal competencies. Ano yung dapat unang matutunan? Ano yung susunod? Ano yung sa huli bago siya lumabas ng program? Para masabi natin na yung future role niya as primary care physician, kaya niyang gawin. And then, we determine the relevance and adequacy of intermediate competencies in order to attain the terminal competencies. So, dito papasok yung ating tinatawag na year-level outcomes. What should the students be able to do or perform at the end of year level 1? Para yung nakaplano nating curriculum for year level 2 will build up or will build on what the student already know or what they can already do. Dapat relevant and adequate ito because these intermediate competencies will help us enable the achievement of the terminal competencies. So, papasok din dito yung paano yung logical and rational sequence ng ating courses, ng ating content, and even the learning activities. Kasi lahat naman ito magdidepende sa curricular objectives or outcomes natin. For the terminal competencies for the MD program, Ched has already identified it for us through the CMO 18 or Ched Memorandum Order 18 series of 2016. So we have 10 program outcomes: demonstrate clinical competence, communicate effectively, lead and manage healthcare teams, engage in research activities, collaborate within interprofessional teams, utilize systems-based approach to healthcare, engage in continuing personal and professional development, adhere to ethical, professional, and legal standards, demonstrate nationalism, internationalism, and dedication to service, and practice the principles of social accountability. So these are terminal competencies for the MD program as prescribed by CHED. So our curriculum should be able to lead to the achievement of these terminal competencies. In addition to these, so we have our own graduate outcomes. So this is identified from the vision, mission, and educational philosophy of BPSU College of Medicine. So we have 4, and we'd like to refer to them as the 4 C's because they all start with the letter C. So that's competent, compassionate, community-oriented, and collaborative. These graduate outcomes are not just from our vision, mission, and educational philosophy, but it is actually aligned with the 10 program outcomes. The third step is answering the question, which approach is suitable? What curricular strategy or a combination of strategies should be used in order to achieve the curricular objectives or the curricular outcomes that will help us address the needs identified during the needs assessment? So we have a plethora of approaches that we can use, from the most traditional or Flexnerian approach, which is teacher-centered, discipline-based, and more focused on gathering information. So that's the traditional approach. We have more innovative approaches in the form of problem-based learning, integrated curriculum, community-based educational approach, which are being argued as more student-centered than the traditional approach. So this is the SPICES model of educational strategies by Ronald Hardin. So each of the first letter of the SPICES stands for a characteristic or an approach that is more innovative compared with the traditional approach. So from this end of the spectrum, we have student-centered, problem-based, integrated, community-based electives, and systematic. On the rightmost, or on the other end of the spectrum, we have the traditional approach, which is, again, teacher-centered, focus on information gathering, discipline-based, hospital-based, and standard, which follows a standard program, and is also apprenticeship-based or opportunistic approach. So, in identifying which curricular strategies is the most appropriate or which is the most suitable in order to achieve the curricular objectives, we can use this model, this is SPICES model of educational strategies, to identify which, again, which one is the most appropriate or suitable. So for BPSU College of Medicine, to align with our vision, mission, and educational philosophy, and to achieve our program and graduate outcomes, our curriculum is going to be an innovative one. Innovative because we will be combining several educational approaches. We will have a hybrid student and teacher-centric approach with curricular content organized by organ system synchronization, but still discipline-based. The percentage of didactics decreases and the number of cases increase as the student advances through the program. The program will follow the standard course with room for electives, and hospital training will also follow CMO 18, and thereby we are also adhering to the outcome-based education. Lastly, we will be strongly community-oriented since we are responding to the Dr. Para Sabayan Act. So I've mentioned a number of quite few educational strategies, and I think I've mentioned them earlier as well. So let's try to define each of these educational approaches. Outcome-based education, in a nutshell, implies the best way to learn is to first determine what needs to be achieved. Once the desired results or exit outcomes have been determined, the strategies, processes, techniques, and means are put in place to achieve the predetermined goals. In essence, it is a working backwards with students as the center of the learning-teaching milieu. So this definition of outcome-based education came from CMO 46, series of 2012, policy standard to enhance quality assurance in Philippine higher education through an outcome-based and typology-based QA. This definition also defines an approach to curricular development. So with outcome-based education is sometimes called performance-based approach because the focus is on what the students can do, not just on what the students know. So with outcome-based education, there's application of knowledge and transferability of this knowledge to different scenarios. When using OBE as an educational approach, the first thing that we have to do is identify the culminating outcomes. And then we design backwards. Design backwards means that we start with the end in mind. So we start by identifying the outcome. Outcomes is what we want the students to be able to do at the end of the program. So that's the end. That's the outcomes. That's our goal. From the outcomes, we design backwards. We identify the other elements of the curriculum. The outcomes will influence all the decisions about the other elements of the curriculum, ensuring that there is alignment of all of these elements. So we identify the outcomes first, and then we design backwards, identifying which content or what content should we include in the curriculum, what technology should we use, what will be the appropriate strategy to use to deliver the content that is still aligned with our learning outcomes. What instructional resources should we use? What tasks should we ask the student to do? What assessment should we use? How will we assess that the student has achieved the culminating outcomes? So all of those elements are influenced by the culminating outcomes. That's why it's called outcome-based. All decisions regarding the curriculum will be based on the outcomes. So this, the diagram I'm showing right now is the OBE systems framework. So this systems framework also ensures quality assurance. QA is not merely defining the standards against which to measure or control quality, but it also includes ensuring that there are mechanisms, procedures, and processes in place to achieve the desired quality. Inherent in OBE is monitoring and evaluation, which is essential to quality assurance. So in this framework, we can also see the four principles of outcome base. So though these are clarity of focus, design down, expanded opportunity, and high expectations. The first OBE principle is clarity of focus. It means that all curriculum design, all instructional delivery, all assessment strategies is geared to what you want the students to demonstrate at the real end. So because the outcomes influence all of the decisions that we have to make about the curriculum, because the outcomes are there, clear sa atin kung ano ang gusto nating ma-achieve. We can focus our curriculum because we have the outcomes. There is a clear goal in mind. So, dahil may outcomes, hindi tayo mawawala sa curriculum natin. We always look at the outcomes. So, outcomes gives clarity of focus. So, that's the first principle of OBE. Second is expanded opportunity, which means expanding the ways a number of times the students get a chance to learn and demonstrate at a very high level whatever they are ultimately expected to learn or to perform. So with OBE, there is room for error. There is room for mistakes, because very important in outcome-based education is feedback. So we always give room for feedback. We use different strategies in order to give the students different learning experiences, varied learning experiences, in which they can repeatedly perform until they are able to perform the outcomes. Third principle, high expectations, which means getting rid of all the bell curve. Because we have the outcomes, clear ang outcomes natin, clear din ang standards natin. No? The outcomes serve as the standard. No? So if the students cannot perform to the standards, if the students cannot achieve the learning outcomes, no? It means that the students are not competent. So again, high expectations get rid of all the bell curve because the outcomes are clear. The last principle is design down. So designing the curriculum back from where you want your students to end up. So this is what I've explained a number of times. This is what I've explained in the previous slide. So these four principles influence all aspects of a system's decision making and operations. So there will be a separate presentation on outcome-based principle. So what I've shown here, what I've presented here is just an introduction or an overview to outcome-based education. But we will have a separate, there is a separate presentation for outcome-based. Next is community-oriented education. This is a curriculum that focuses on population groups and individual persons which take into account the health needs of the community concerned. COE, or community-oriented education, is a response to the prevailing criticisms of modern medicine which is allegedly focused on individual needs. Community-oriented education attempted to reorient healthcare towards addressing the needs of the population and the relevant factors that contribute to health and disease, including the physical and social environment, etc. So it attempted to place the efforts of medicine in a more complete and appropriate context. Community-oriented education is different from community-based education. In CBE, there is involvement of the community throughout the learning experience. Now, the community is used as the main learning environment. That's community-based. But the curriculum is based on what the community really needs. So that's community-based. Community-oriented is more on the content and the strategy. So with community-oriented education, there is a curricular implication in terms of content and strategy. So the content and the strategy are oriented towards what the community needs. It uses the community as the learning environment, but not the sole learning environment. So that's in contrast to community-based education. Integrated curriculum, on the other hand, is the organization of teaching matter to interrelate or unify subjects frequently taught in separate academic courses or departments. So in an integrated curriculum, there is a deliberate unification of separate areas of knowledge. Now, in medicine, the most common manner in which to integrate the curriculum is through the organ systems based approach. So the curricular implication ng integrated curriculum sa organization ng content. So what are the advantages of an integrated curriculum? It more reflects the practice of medicine, because in medicine, there is a holistic view of the patient and is his or her problems. So when looking at the patient, you don't look at the patient through the lens of one discipline. But there's integration. There's holistic view, diba, of the patient. It also motivates the students due to the relevance. Because it clearly reflects the practice of medicine, the students can see clearly the relevance of what they are studying about. So it motivates them. It increases their motivation. It also relates with integration. We relate theory to practice, making learning more effective, again, because of relevance. we eliminate unnecessary reduplication. So, with integration, yung itinuro sa isang subject, hindi na kailangang ituro sa iba pa. Diba? For example, anatomy. No? So, kung itinuro na sa anatomy, hindi mo na kailangan balikan pa sa physio. And it promotes collaboration and communication between faculty members. No? Because more faculty members, because you have to integrate the curriculum, no? The faculty members who are the content experts of each area, they have to work together to integrate the curriculum. So it thereby promotes collaboration and communication between the faculty members. No? Isa kasi sa common scenario is yung mga teachers, they are so focused dun lang sa course na ituturo nila. No? So they don't even know na yung tinuturo nila na ituro na pala sa iba. So that's reduplication, no? While in some cases okay yung repetitive, no, may times na hindi, no, may times na hindi okay yung ulit-ulit, no, kasi it becomes a waste of time na sana naitaas mo na yung ituturo mo pa, pero you have to go back to the lower order, no, kasi hindi mo alam na itinuro na siya sa ibang subjects. So that's one advantage of integration. And the last step in the curriculum planning process is curriculum evaluation. So it answers the questions, how are we doing? Curriculum evaluation is the process of delineating, obtaining, and providing useful information for decision-making alternatives. So earlier I mentioned the importance of monitoring and evaluation. There are several frameworks that we can use when evaluating a curriculum. But we will stop here. We will not discuss what these frameworks are. But we'll go into that once we are evaluating our curriculum already. So in summary, curriculum planning has four elements. A curriculum has four elements. That's needs assessment, curricular objectives, curricular strategies, and curricular evaluation. Each of these elements answer a directional question. Needs assessment answers the question, where are we now? Curricular objectives answers the question, what is our direction? Curricular strategies answer the questions, which approach is suitable to bring us from this point to this point? Curricular evaluation answers the question, how are we doing? To evaluate whether we have reached our objectives or we have used the correct strategies to help us achieve our objectives and address our needs. So that's it for the curriculum planning process. Thank you very much for listening.